thank you so much for taking time out and talking to the entire student community. With whatever is happening in the world right now, we need more and more people, we need more and more leaders like you to come forward and tell the world about, you know, how the things are going to be. My first question for you is, with whatever is happening right now, when do you see the industry gearing up to hire internationals, or is it already happening, or people who are already there about to fly to the US to start their MBA? What do you think? How does it look like?
Jatin, thanks for having me here. It's always great to talk to you, and also through you to talk to the applicants or aspirants for MBA. But if people are doing MBA for the right reasons, that they are here for a long-term play, they want to understand when, why, where, and what they are trying to do with their life, it doesn't matter. COVID or no COVID, it won't matter. It's only a matter of time. It's a matter of time when their experience, their expertise, and what they want to do in life will align with someone else who is also trying to do the same thing, and they will just get hired and they will keep shining.
What suggestions do you have for people, Ashutosh, who are right now looking at applying in round one, and they are 4 months away from August, the round one, and they'll be starting their MBA in August 2021. I see a lot of these people getting worried about their jobs, and a lot of GMAT centers not operational right now, so people are taking GMAT at home, GRE at home. What suggestions do you have for people like these who are planning to start their MBA in a year from now, in August of 2021?
That's a great question, Jatin, and I think you captured it really well on your LinkedIn message, is that we can think about a spectrum of people. You rightly said that someone who is graduating just now, like in summer, in June or July of this year, things are not going to be really great for them unless they have already secured an offer which is going to be honored by an employer. Unless that's the case, things are going to be a little bumpy for at least short term. And then this is one end of the spectrum. The other end of the spectrum is someone writing a GMAT in next couple of months. It's for them, I think it's a no-brainer. Nothing changes for them. When economic situation get worse, it doesn't get worse in US alone. It gets worse everywhere. This is a global pandemic. It will affect jobs in India as well. The job prospects, the promotion prospects will get affected there. If people consider an MBA as an investment in their own betterment so that they are more employable, they have more transferable skills that will be accepted, recognized everywhere, I think it's a no-brainer for this end of the spectrum who are just trying to write their GMAT or who have got an admit and they will start their course in MBA in 2021. It will be, people will forget about what happened by the time they graduate.
Thank you for that. Ashutosh, I want to come to your experiences at Stanford. And I'm talking to you after 4 years when we worked together. You've changed drastically, significantly as a person. Can you help a layman? Layman is somebody sitting in India who's thinking of higher education abroad. Can you focus on how did your education from Stanford impact your career? Like, how are your pre-Stanford capabilities different from what you're doing right now? How have you expanded in life?
Yeah, it's a loaded question, Jatin. I'll say this, and you tell me if I'm responding, I'm taking more time to come to the point. But it's a different, difficult question, understanding how has an education affected you, or a time you spend at a school has affected you. As I said, the life is between tangibles and intangibles. If we chase tangibles all the time, those are short term, they lose value. But intangibles are something that we need to understand. I think you told me this equation is A plus B equals C plus D. A is for an applicant, B for business school, C for career, and D for destination or destiny. And an applicant wants to go to D. They can't go to D unless they have B somewhere, right? So a B is the B school. An applicant tells the school, hey, if you give me what I'm looking for in terms of B, I'm going to go to D anyway. But when I go there, you will get famous. So, and I'm looking for, in terms of B, what I'm looking for is may, it could be hard knowledge about how to do scaling of a business. If I want to start a startup, can you teach me what are the common pitfalls that other people have seen that I don't have to repeat my mistakes to learn from them? How do you manage financing? How do you manage venture capitalists? All those kinds of hard knowledge is one part. But then when you go to Stanford, there are 30,000 alumni who graduated from business school alone. And Stanford has multiple schools. There are more than 200,000 people there. And before I graduated, I had to take an oath that anytime anyone who is a prospect to Stanford or an alumni from Stanford, if they reach out to me, my first duty will be to respond to them. That's a code. And I never saw that code broken when I was looking for a job. I reached out to people who were the chairman or the CEO or like managing 10, 20, $100 billion businesses. They responded like same day, and I was at least getting a phone call, if nothing else. With whom you are sitting in the classroom, it's so. You know, I went to the admission committee and I said, why did you take me? Looks like I don't even belong here. The people around me, they're so accomplished. Someone who has sold 3 companies, sitting on about $100 million, doesn't know what to do with that. And they just get in the class and trying to understand what they really want. Someone who was the CEO of a company was in my class. So one person from IIM Ahmedabad, he was in my class. So different people who have different background, you learn so much from them. The way they carry themselves, the way they pursue their life, the way they find meaning in their life, all those kinds of things you can't get from textbooks. And those are the things you can't place value on them. And when you are there, you meet people, the guest faculties, the network that you create there, that opens your mind from the function that you have been working. For example, many people who apply for MBA, they come from certain function, certain job. Their mind is conditioned to think that way. I'm only going to work in this industry. I'm only going to work in this function. I never imagined working in a software company. But it opens your mind. It gives you a plethora of opportunities in life. Is that it doesn't matter what you have been working on, what you have been doing. What matters is that are you passionate enough to change yourself to in pursuit of something greater than just good enough? That's a paradigm shift that you get when you go to a school like Stanford. I'll keep going, man, but I want to be respectful of your time.
Somebody who's not been to places like Stanford, Harvard, Wharton, Columbia, and they're applying from here, what do you think are some of the challenges that international applicants are not aware of and they should know of before they start their campus journey? Like people who get in and they don't know something is going to hit them once you're there. What would you do differently 6 months before starting your MBA journey?
Some things that I did right and some things I did wrong. I'll throw light on both of them, hoping that it will give some perspective. So what some good schools do is that even before the classes start, they invite you for a weekend so you can spend some time with the outgoing class and learn from their experience and get your alignment done. I did that. That's the right thing that I did for a person living in India and funding that ticket, return ticket to US just to meet the class. It might be overspending when you are already planning $175,000 investment. It might be something that you would like to preserve, but that was the best investment I made after the fee to the Stanford school. Thinking from that, like just trying to absorb the campus, meet as many people, even if you can't visit, at least talk to them, build network to the outgoing class. And they have so many gems and pearls that they have collected and it's fresh in their memory, do's and don'ts. And don't just connect with your community. If you are an Indian, you talk to Indians. Collect widespread perspective. In my class, there were 91 passports. 91 passports across 91 countries. Talk to different people and think, why did they come here? Did they achieve what they wanted? And what are some do's and don'ts? just get collect and that will help transition you from being a person who was in a country to prepare yourself to be in that mold. It will take time, definitely. It's a cultural shock sitting in a classroom. American pedagogy is very different. We are conditioned very differently, that we take permission before entering the class. We take permission before exiting the class. We are shy in before asking the question. So many things. We don't take initiative to reach out to people. We consider professor as here higher than us, and we have, you know, some sort of inhibition before asking stupid question or before reaching out and say, hey, professor, can you help me? And things here are very different. Is that no? It's you are considered a responsible person, a person responsible for your life. People expect and assume that you know what you're doing. If you have to get out of the class, nobody is going to ask you a question. It's your call. It's your life. And if you want to reach out to someone, you reach out as equal. Those are the kind of things that take time for your brain to register and build the muscle memory around them. Those are the things that if you can prepare faster before getting an admission, that will position you so well on the runway that you will start, you know, hit the road running. That would be my advice to the students.
Can you describe your typical day on campus? How did it look like? A day in the life of Ashutosh on the Stanford campus.
Go there, man. Look, so my course was a little different. I did not have a luxury of, like an undergrad spends 4 years on campus. My life at the campus was limited. There was so much to do. So we only had 12 months, right? And we were supposed to take 55 credits to graduate, not more, not less. But this is a different school. It doesn't matter. You take an admission at B school, but there are six other schools. You can take classes anywhere you want, right? So I ended up having like 75 credits within those 12 months. I took classes at the drama school. I was taking classes in acting. I took classes in engineering school. I took one class in law school because I was passionate about negotiation. And it was very different class at law school. So I used to go there almost every week to get into the class. I took classes at different schools, different faculties, arts. I took class psychology class at the undergrad level to understand how the brain functions. And there is so much available. You don't even want to sleep. Like most of us, we had problems sleeping that if I close my eyes, I'm going to miss an opportunity to immerse myself more. So that's the kind of situation you are in, is that you have so much to do. You have so much to take into. You don't even want to spend time doing anything else. At the same time, I was working on my startup. So I started a company while studying. So I made my life even more miserable. But we did well. I and two of my classmates, we founded this, and we were the semi-finalists in across the Stanford startup competition. So I made my life even more miserable. Even after graduating, I was still working on my startup while other people, my classmates, were looking for jobs 6 months before graduating. So my life was a little different. I was an outlier.
I remember you had to choose between, there was a time in your life when you and I were talking about Ahmedabad, I'm Ahmedabad versus Stanford. And you spoke with everyone that you could in Stanford in India. You were very close to payment deposit deadlines of these schools. Remember? Like you were very, very close to whom to pay. Should I start here? And finally you chose Stanford. How do you see that decision now?
I think it was, you advised me, Jatin. I came to you. I asked people at IIM. I talked to people at Stanford. So I had good friends, I would say that those who knew how to make right decisions. I visited IIM campus, met with people, looked at their classrooms, looked at where they study and everything, trying to, you know, get the feel. I did not have that feel from Stanford, of course, at that time. But when I had that feeling, I didn't really like it. I felt that it would be a compromise. It won't be something that I want to do.